Good afternoon. My name is Sam Miller. I serve as the Vice President for Student Affairs here at Southwestern, and will serve as the moderator for today's panorama. At this time, we invite President Patterson to the podium.
Thank you, Dr. Miller, and thank you to our participants for coming today to share their experience, and for our faculty, staff, and students that are in attendance today to hear about their experiences and to share upon that. The Panorama series, when I came here, had just started. And it was really a unique experience for me attending a couple of these now, because it's really a great opportunity to share experiences, to voice opinions in a collegial way. And if there's one thing that I'm very, very proud of this campus, is the collegial atmosphere that we have here at Georgia Southwestern State University. What we're going to talk about today, race and race relations from the 1960s to today, can be a controversial topic, but that's what the panorama is for, to be able to discuss those types of topics in the following ways. We're all products of our environment. Everyone here grew up in a different environment. Whether you're African American, whether you're an international, whether you're born in the US, you're born in the South, you're born in the Northeast, we all are products of our environment. But one of the great things is our ability to change and adapt. We're animals in some respects, and we do change. We change the way we behave, we change the way we think, we change for the positive or for the negative. But the university experience helps mold us. It helps make us who we are. And that is the beauty of attending a college or a university. It helps you think in different ways. I can personally say for me, I grew up in a very good environment, a very good home environment. I can't say it was free from prejudice, but I can adapt. With my son, we have one son, and my wife Colleen is here. We helped raise our son in a race-neutral environment. He wasn't protected. He was exposed to different races, different opportunities, different experiences. But we didn't point things out to him. We let him learn on his own. And a couple of anecdotes here in the way he grew up. There's a story that goes, you know, Colleen was at the grocery store and we're checking out. And our son, who's in the carriage, looks at the guy who's bagging the groceries, and he looks at him and he says, "Hey, you're black." And the guy says, "Yes, I am." But it was that type of environment he grew up in. We didn't teach him right or wrong. We taught him to be respectful, absolutely. And our son, like his father, is blue-eyed, red-haired, white-skinned. That means when I go out in the sun, I have to put sunblock on. And as a child, he does too. And when he came home from kindergarten one day, he said, "Mom, so-and-so needs to wear more sunscreen." "Why?" "Well, she's really dark." "Well, yes, she's African American." And that's an opportunity for us to begin to explain the differences in the cultures, an opportunity and a learning experience to explain the difference in races, but in a very positive way. And so he's grown up in a very diverse environment, being in higher education, and it should be diverse. And I can tell you, looking at our own faculty and staff makeup and our student makeup, on the faculty and staff side, we have 266 faculty and staff. We have a 13.5% of our faculty and staff are African American, 80% are white, 3% are Asian, and other races make up the remaining 100%. Of our fall enrollment of 2,755, we have 27% African Americans. We have 64% white students, 3% Asian, and again, 6% others. Our population of students here at this university. It's quite diverse. It's representative in a bit of what we would expect in higher education institutions in the Southwest, South Georgia. How are we doing in diversity? That's a good question. It's one of the questions I've posed. What's the environment like on our campus? What's the environment like in our region? That's part of the conversation we'll have today. But to be proactive in this, as we approach diversity, I have formed the Council on Diversity, representative of, or represented by, our faculty, staff, and students at the university. Because I, as a president, want to be proactive in how we approach these discussions. It's incumbent upon us to be proactive. From what I've seen, we have an environment on campus that, again, is collegial, and that extends down to our student body. And I'm very proud of our students for being collegial. But I want to know what your experience are, or your experiences are. And so through this council, we'll continue to have discussions about policy, process, and programs. What are we doing as a university in our policies and process to ensure diversity? And what are we doing as a university in our programming to make sure that our students and our student groups are diverse, and at least the way they interact together and the programs that we provide for them? So you'll see more information on that coming forward. And I would invite our students strongly to attend the next forum on the 29th, that's March 29th, this coming Tuesday, at 4:30 here in this nursing building. I've asked several of our Council on Diversity to help me compose a panel of students, because I want to hear from the student voice what their environment's like. What is the environment like on this campus, and how can we improve it? So I'd like to hear your feedback on that as well. But again, I thank our panelists for coming today and sharing their experiences, and I'll turn things over to our moderator, Dr. Sam Miller.
I would like to begin by introducing the members of today's panel, and then I will explain the procedural details for the panel discussion. Our panelists are Mrs. Linda Randall. Mrs. Randall, the first year advocate here at GSW, moved to Americus from Massachusetts in July 2010. For over 40 years, Mrs. Randall has built a distinguished award-winning career working in higher education in the social service field. She is a product and a strong supporter of public education. She is a proud alumna of the Upward Bound program, where she was first introduced to the life-changing possibilities of higher education and the complexity of race relations in America. She holds a master's degree in education with a concentration in counseling psychology and diversity education from the University of Massachusetts at Amherst. In May 2012, she received the GSW President's Excellence in University Service Award and was promoted to Director of the Academic Resource Center, in addition to her busy role as first year advocate. She is a staunch supporter of student life at GSW and serves as campus advisor to the African Students Association. Mrs. Randall has been married to her partner and friend, Charles L. Randall Jr., for 25 years. Between them, they are the parents of five daughters and currently have nine grandchildren ranging in ages from 29 to 3 years old. Mr. Sam Mahone, born and raised in Americus, a former field secretary and student leader with the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, SNCC, from 1963 to 1966 in Americus in Southwest Georgia. Presently serving as chairman of the America's Sumter County Movement Remembered Committee, whose mission is to collect, preserve, and achieve all documentation, including artifacts and memorabilia of the America's Civil Rights Movement of the 1960s. Currently living in Atlanta, where he's a docent at the new National Center for Civil and Human Rights. Mr. Quentin Lowden. Mr. Lowden is a visual artist from Atlanta. He studied at Georgia Southwestern State University, where he received a BFA in drawing and painting. His work examines issues surrounding identity, access and exposure, community, and empathy. Colonel Eric D. Bryant, born and reared here in Americus, graduate of Americus High and South Georgia Police Academy, attended Albany State and the University of Georgia, served 6 years in the United States Marine Corps Reserve, employed in public service since 1995, currently serving as chief deputy at the Sumter County Sheriff's Office, married and the father of three boys, willing, ready, able. Ms. Sheila Pree Bright. Ms. Bright is an artist and actionist from Atlanta, Georgia. She holds a master's degree in fine arts with a concentration in photography from Georgia State University. Sheila's work has been presented in exhibitions nationally and internationally. Her work has also been included in collections at the National Center for Civil and Human Rights, the Library of Congress, the High Museum of Art, and the Smithsonian National Museum of African American History. Those are the panelists. And here are some of the procedural details. Each panelist has been asked to prepare opening remarks on their area of expertise, and each panelist will be given up to 10 minutes to share their remarks. At the 9-minute mark, I'll signal them to alert the panelists to complete his or her point of discussion and wrap it up within 60 seconds. Once all panelists have made their opening remarks, we will transition to the question and answer portion of the discussion. During this period, panelists will respond to questions from the audience. As the moderator, my role will be to facilitate distribution of questions from the panelists, but I will not be responding to questions. However, if you would like to direct a question to a specific panelist, you may do so. For the question and answer portion, we have two mic stations. So we will ask anyone with a question to come to one of those two mic stations to pose your question or comment. In the interest of time, we would like to ask that questions or comments from the audience are stated within 1 minute. If you are a student, we ask you to state your name and major. If you are faculty, staff, or community member, please state your name and your professional title before stating your question or comment. Our panelists will provide their remarks in the following order: Mrs. Linda Randall, Mr. Sam Mahone, Mr. Quentin Lonan, Mr. Eric Bryant, and Ms. Sheila Pree Bright. Without further delay, let's begin with our first panelist, Mrs. Randall.
To bear with me for a moment, I, like many of you, are succumbing to the allergy season. Prior to getting here, I had a coughing fit, and I figured that I must be coming to say something important because that's usually what happens whenever I try to say something important, something goes wrong. So, good afternoon. I always say when I'm doing these things that technology is our friend. When it's good, it's really, really good. And like the girl with the curl on her forehead, when it's bad, it's horrid. So I'm going to hope that the technology piece that will accompany me is going to work. Okay, great. So Dr. Miller read my bio. I just want to say a couple of things. One of the reasons that I worked really hard and lobbied, to be quite frank, to be on this panel is because I have been doing this work for many, many years of my life. As you can see, my life is very long. Those of you who know me know I'm not good at math, which is why they invented calculators. But for those of you who can do the math, God willing, I will see 61 in August. So I've been around a minute. Although I don't think I'm the oldest panelist, but I'm a contemporary, a number of folks in the room. I'm asking you, as I come to you before, to suspend judgment, which is not to say you're a room full of judgers by any means, and I don't mean to insult you, but what I want you to do as we go into the panel is to just think about everything that everyone is saying. To think about it, even as Dr. Patterson alluded to, that this experience of the other or an other may be very different than your experience of life, but it is equally valid and it is equally important that we listen to the voices of others and try to understand some things, because right now our country is in a really interesting place, and that's part of my remarks. So I just want to do this really quickly. We're going to have a really quick history, trip through history, really quick, I promise. So just in my short lifetime, which I put short for all the older people in the room because you know it is, and some of you will figure that out sooner or later, hopefully, all right? So in 1954 was Brown versus the Board of Education, the decision in the Supreme Court. On December 1st, 1955, with Sister Rosa Parks, with whom all of you know about, if you know nothing else about black history, everybody teaches about Rosa Parks. So I was about 3 months old when Rosa Parks sat down. Okay, in 1964, the Civil Rights Act, okay, which other folks will allude to because they worked so hard to make that come to fruition, okay. I am a product of LBJ's war on poverty because I'm a product of Upward Bound. Any other trio people in the room? Where are my trios at? All right, thank you, good to see you. All right, so I'm a product of that. Without that war on poverty, now you may look around and think that poverty won, but we did have some laws called the war on poverty in a campaign, and we'll talk about that a little bit too. But without the intervention of trio in my life, I would never be standing before you today. And I definitely would have never moved to Georgia. Okay, so, all right. In 1965 is the Voting Rights Act. Lots of efforts being made right now to roll that back and to do deliberate acts to erode those rights. We'll talk about that as the day goes on. Okay, and in 1971, I call it my awakening. And I'm gonna do this really quickly. I grew up in a small town in the hills of Massachusetts, as many of you grow up in small hilly places, maybe, or less hilly places in Georgia. And at 15, I got plucked from my very rural area and went to the University of Massachusetts for Upward Bound. The thing about the Upward Bound was that when I got there, I was, for the first time in my life, a minority. Because I'm part of the dominant population, my hard candy shell appears to be what it is. And so in the town I grew up in, everybody looked like me. And so I had never been around anybody that was different from me. But all of a sudden, I went from being a dominant and being normal and being neutral and everything being the way it is to being a minority. And it was the most amazing, scary, but amazing transformation, because that is what informed the rest of my life. From that first moment where I stepped on that campus and found myself looking at life through a different set of eyes and feeling differently than I felt when I was out and about in my own life, my life as I knew it. And so that created a degree of sensitivity in me and a degree of understanding about things. Now, I will never insult any person of color and say I understand what it is to be black, feels to be black, or Latino, or anything else. That would be foolish and insulting. But I do have this level, and I made it, at that point in time, at only 15, and I mean this, I made it my life's work that I was always going to work on this. This would be something that gripped me when we look at our mission in life, when we look at what we're going to do, when we look at what we're going to do with our lives, that from that moment on, I knew that this was part of what I was going to do with my life. So I'll move along, just so you understand how I got to be who I am. And for those of you who've wondered that for a long time, there's a clue. All right. So I'm calling my little piece, and I will move quickly, the New American Revolution. And in the New American Revolution, some of you are old enough to know that the revolution will not be televised. All right, it will not be brought to you by Coke, and that is spelled it was spelled C-O-K-E back in the day, not K-O-C-H. Some of you will get that on the way home. All right, but I'm looking for common ground. In the New American Revolution, we're going to find a way to find the common ground that we've yet to find. We've got miles to go. We're going to go to literature, miles to go before we sleep, but we are on a road. And there are many soldiers on the panel, there are many soldiers in the audience, but we've got work to do. But unity has never meant uniformity. And I refer to, throughout my presentation, to Martin Luther King, not because I don't know anybody else, not because I don't know other revolutionary spirits, but because I take this from the book, Why We Can't Wait. And when people say, what's going on now, what's going on? We are now looking back at history and we're living it all over again. So why we can't wait. And others will address that much more clearly as we go on. All right? So I had occasion to go to the Man of the La Mancha the other night. Anybody go to community theater the other evening here in town? Okay, well, the Man of La Mancha talks about this thing called the impossible dream. And there are people in this room, and certainly people in larger society, who believe that that people like me and other people in this audience are just mad men or mad women jousting at windmills. But the reality is, this is the lyrics from the song, The Impossible Dream, for those of you who don't know what it is. And so this is the mantra. This is the guiding for lots of people, including me. Writing unrightable wrongs and loving and pushing. Pushing when your arms are too weary. Pushing when we just can't take it anymore. Pushing when all reason says don't, just give up. Just pushing on. And so my quest is to follow that star. And it says no matter how hopeless, because there's lots of times it looks hopeless, I assure you, and to march into hell for it. No, I'm sorry for the religious, but it's in the lyrics for those of you who don't do religion. Okay, but for a heavenly cause or whatever you hold true as a cause. And for me, I will do this work till the day I draw my last breath. Because I think it's that important. The reason I'm an educator, the reason I'm sharing it with you is because I want you as young people to think it's that important. Because if I'm my age and there are lots of other soldiers older than me, then we have to pass the baton on to someone. And I need you to be there to take up that fight. Because it is a fight. It isn't given up. It isn't given up. Power does not concede power. And power all by itself. All right? So, I call myself a visionary realist. All right? I don't think of myself as a fool, and I don't think of myself as foolhardy, although some of you have met me. All right, a visionary realist. I see a vision of where we can get, but I'm a realist. Okay? I'm not just someone who just is always pie in the sky and Pollyanna about things. Visionary and realist. And I, back at the time of these movements that we're talking about from 1960 to now, and now and going forward, that was prophetic back then. The movement for common ground was prophetic back then, and we're here again. Okay? Obviously, you can read, so I won't read for you. Okay? I hope I don't need to. We're in college. Okay? If it just moves people, though, it's a revolt. movement that changes people and institutions. We are looking under the direction of our president. We're talking about making revolutionary change on this campus. Council on Diversity is not going to be, it's not my intention, and the folks who are going to serve on it, it's not our intention that we will just, you know, be a figurehead body. We'll just be a body that just is ceremonial. We're here to look at policy. We're here to look at decisions that are made. We're here to look at what happens with students on our campus and where do we go from here. So we're not looking for a revolt. We're looking for a revolution. Okay? The revolution? Yes. Okay. So the revolution is genuine because it was born from the same womb as all other movements. All right? It's all right. This is an important one. Some folks say, don't move so fast, and some people say, just get in there and stir it all up, all right? And they think they're at opposite poles, but the reality is that there's a striking parallel between both of those from either extreme. And if you're in my class, you know we talk about balance all the time, all right? If you don't reach the folk who need the most help, then it's just a lot of talk. Okay? I want to hit this point, and then I will soon take my seat at your prompting, okay? Automation, all right? What we see happening in our country right now is because the Negro was the first to suffer it. But if you look at where our jobs have gone, if you're looking at education, if you're looking that we don't have all of our people, certainly among minority communities, which I hate to call minority communities, people of color, if you look at that, certainly, there's a saying that says when the United States, when the country gets a cold, black people get the flu, all right? So the point is, that's what we're seeing, and a lot of young people that are disenfranchised, a lot of people that are going in certain direction around their vote is because we are not keeping up with. The jobs are not here, and it's about jobs for so many people, all right? I'm going to skip that one, all right? The straitjacket of prejudice and discrimination is not only Southern. People in North always like to blame our Southern cousins. I promise you that things are not that good down North. I grew up there, I know this. And the old guard in society resents new methods for old guards where decorations and medal by waging the battle in the accepted manner. When you try to understand about Black Lives Matter, when you try to understand about folks who are really trying to shake things up and bring things to our social conscience, it's not popular. It wasn't popular back in Sam's time, when Sam was doing this work. And a lot of folks, you know, were not with Malcolm. A lot of folks were not with Martin, okay? They got with the program after he became famous, after it became acceptable. So there's lots of folks who sit on the fence, who sit on the sidelines, but when the time comes, you know, they don't know nothing until it's been made effective by someone else. So I thank you for our time. I'm going to hear, okay? I'm inviting you to join the quest. And it is a glorious quest. And it's not pie in the sky, and it's not silly, and it's not just ultra-liberal folks. It's people who are Americans who want to see a better country for everybody in this country. And I'm asking you to join us. Thank you. Sorry.
Good afternoon. I'd like to begin by saying that I am a 1964 graduate of Sumter County High School, Americus, Georgia. Something I'm very proud of, and it's those experiences growing up here led me on a path that I took over 50 years ago, and that is struggling for the rights of people of color who had been disenfranchised throughout the South and many parts of the Northeast as well. I was excited when I was approached about this forum simply because it is my hometown. It is and I'm very, very concerned about what's happening in our country today on the streets of America. It's taken us back to a time that I thought many of us, I'm sure, thought had long since passed. So I'm going to read a statement and we can take it from there. My purpose here tonight is to engage particularly students and faculty and teachers alike, and to challenge them to introduce them to a more accurate, complex, and engaging understanding of United States history than is found in traditional textbooks or curricula. In fact, if one really wants to understand the real America, he must almost totally unlearn everything he has been taught about freedom and liberty in America. He has to literally erase that from memory and begin again. As painful and excruciating as that may sound to some, that is the only way you will understand America's race dilemma. Tonight's discussion on race relations has to begin with the long and sordid history of inhumane treatment of, and America's dehumanization of African Americans via the slave trade and the subsequent methods to have them remain as chattel property and second-class citizens. That is first and foremost. It is only within this context and framework that we can understand and comprehend what is taking place on the streets of our cities today, or even this year's presidential campaign among Republican candidates. It is only within this context that we can understand that 50 years after horrific battles of the civil rights movement of the 60s, we find it necessary to resurrect that movement in the form of Black Lives Matter today. You see, America has never come to terms with its racist past, which is necessary to advance the cause of truth, reconciliation, healing, and yes, reparations. This is an essential component to any full transition to a full and free democracy. Wrongs have to be righted, and an acknowledgement of those wrongs have to be made. To this day, there has never been any expressions of remorse, sorrow, or a single document from the U.S. government apologizing for the immoral and inhumane treatment and enslavement of Africans, followed by the ruthless oppression and deprivation, not to mention the psychological, social, and physical damage done to African Americans in this country. This is not an indictment of everyone in American society, but it's something that we have to come to terms with, we have to face if we're going to solve the problem of race in this country. And I hope people see it that way and keep an open mind in terms of when we talk about these true issues that we have to talk about. As we fast forward to this day, the election of the nation's first African-American president reveals once again a nation unable to sustain an enduring commitment to civil rights. His election brought immediate claims of illegitimacy and dismantling of hard-won civil rights legislation such as the Voting Rights Act and the evisceration of equal protection to due process in the national criminal justice system. His historic individual accomplishment has been upstaged by a collective racist rage ranging from police murders, murders of Black men and women, to videotape police brutality, to hate killings, and race baiting by Republican presidential candidates. And while these injustices occur in plain sight, there is a collective outrage. There is no collective outrage from folks who are content to remain silent and comforted by what I would call white skin privilege, which allows you to simply look the other way and remain in the now of continuing racial injustices and inequities in this country. You see, racism is about power and who holds that power. And any advancement by African Americans in this country has always been followed by a white backlash that does not want to share that power. It comes in the forms of recrimination and oppression of African Americans, Mexicans, Muslims, and attempts to exploit, divide them, to pit them against one another, and dehumanize them. This is truth. We have to accept that. This is the reality we see being played out today as politicians evoke code words like take my country back. Now, those of us who've been in this battle, we know what that code word refers to. We know what that means. And so this is a term that's played out loosely all over the country by presidents and candidates, people who want to run this country, who know that it's a divisive term, who know exactly what they're doing when they say this term. It's a striking parallel to what this country went through over 150 years ago after the Emancipation Proclamation, when we saw the rise of the Ku Klux Klan, we saw the advent of groups who, legislatures who passed legislation to initiate things that were called the Black Codes which were initiated to prevent African Americans from assembling, for worshiping, right to hold jobs, even to learn and read and write. These were all meant to contain black people after liberation, so-called liberation. And we went from that to the Red Riots of the 1900s, 1919, when black soldiers returned from World War I after having given up their lives fighting for this country, came back to this country, couldn't find jobs, couldn't find places to live, and were literally hunted down and attacked and killed and murdered in the streets of America. Race riots all over the country. These were all efforts to contain black people in this country while the nation remained silent. And so it remains a cancer in this country, a cancer that will eventually destroy us from within if we don't come together and have dialogue like you see here today. But it is something that mostly whites have to take the lead on. Whites who will take the time to come out of the denial and confront what is clearly an issue that you have to deal with. It's not just on African Americans, but it's on everyone to do that. But white folks have to take the lead. Thank you.
Hello. All right, so first I just kind of want to thank everybody for coming out. I know that this is not exactly the easiest discussion to have for any party, someone on the polar opposites or for those in the middle. So I want to personally thank you. I think this is a good step in the right direction. I kind of wanted to highlight what I think would be what would constitute success for tonight? And for me, that means that we walk away with different perspectives than our own, all of us, including the panelists. And then the second thing is kind of understanding our role in becoming the solution. So I don't think the solution is some kind of thing separate from ourselves, but we, each person in this room, is the solution to race issues in America. So I have basically three points that I want to try and cover really quick in these 10 minutes. And the first one is denial. So the first step towards moving into a better direction away from race issues, or from where we are right now in race issues in America, is to not deny that there is an issue anymore. If we just want to speak about this town, there is clearly a white side of town, and there's a black side. Now, I don't know, maybe you guys don't see that, but you know, I have walked around America a lot. I like to walk and ride my bike, and it's very clear. It's very clear. There are disparities in home wealth, home income, job opportunities, There are disparities in healthcare. So these things exist. And I think it's important that we take note that they exist and not, you know, close our eyes to them. And when we're thinking about this, I think about identity. Our identity as Americans, as a people, is based on what we choose to accept and don't accept. And so if we are in denial, then we're moving, you know, away from what we could be. So when I think about identity, I think about this topic of bias. I know when we think about race and racism, we think about this very, like, visceral, you know, like, I hate you type thing. But I think what we're really fighting against is this idea of bias. So I'm going to tell you, like, a quick little story about me. So I really like all people. You know, I'm very culturally open. I like to experience new cultures and new people. And so when I was staying here, I lived with two people who came from China. And at the time, one guy came from Saudi Arabia. And he didn't have a car, so I drove him around often. It was kind of annoying, but I was like, I would want somebody to drive me around if I couldn't. So, you know, we got to talk a lot. And I asked him why he was here, and he said he wanted to learn English. And he wanted to submerse himself and just kind of learn about America. And the reason why he wanted to do that is because he wanted to pass a test so he could learn how to fly a plane. Now, I'm not like, no Muslims, no, you know, but instantly that just kind of flashed in my mind. You know, like, you know, it wasn't very long before I was like, don't think that, that's kind of silly, you know, I don't even believe that. But my bias came out. Not what I believe, but my bias. And so I think in these situations like Ferguson and all of the shootings and the things that we see happening, I think sometimes it is just racial bigotry. But sometimes in the split moment when you have to make a decision, your bias will come out before your rationale and what you actually believe. So I think just keeping that in mind is important. So the second point I wanted to come up with or discuss was comfort, this idea of comfort. This topic is not comfortable, and nothing about it really is comfortable for anyone. I mean, you know, like, I'm not even exactly that comfortable, you know. But it's important that we talk about it. So it's important that we understand and learn to become comfortable with our discomfort. I think that's really important, because then that allows you to really navigate waters that you don't really want to navigate. I mean, if you think about everyone's New Year's resolution, I want to lose weight. Well, what do you have to do? Be uncomfortable for like a whole year before you can maybe lose those 20 pounds. But you commit, you know, because you know I got to be uncomfortable for a while and then I'll start to see the payoff. So it's a very similar thing. When I think about this, I think about this idea that we say President Obama is a president. You know, we have like Colin Powell, Condoleezza Rice. We have all these really successful black figures, and it's easy to think, well, there's no racism in America. But we have to think, even in slavery and in the Jim Crow time, there were exceptions. You know, there were free black men during slavery. There were successful black entrepreneurs during Jim Crow. So it's not these successful figures definitely are, they show us what we can do and what we can achieve, but they don't necessarily speak for everyone, every individual case. So we can't look at it in that way. I actually have a slide. So a guy named Rich Benjamin, he did a 2-year study and he traveled tens of thousands of miles across America, where he basically went to what he called whitetopias. These whitetopias were virtually 100% white, virtually no crime, very community oriented. Almost every week they would have some kind of community based thing where they were like rallying against whatever stuff they didn't like. And they had lots of money and they were like really nice. These were virtually utopias. Like when you think about utopia, going on vacation for the rest of your life, like these were those places. And so what going there and being there, what he learned, he kept hearing this same thing. And they would say, you know, one black person it's a treat. You know, it's like, cool. You know, it's good to meet you. It's good to know. But 50 black people is a ghetto. So what he started to realize was that there's this push and pull to whitetopia, which kind of seeps into the rest of America, white America, I guess. And I mean, even black people. I mean, we can't There's always lines that are a little bit blurry. So what he realized is that white people are pushed away from, or white topias, the people who live in these are pushed away from illegals, legal immigrants, crowded neighborhoods, and all of these things on this side. And they're pulled towards merit, freedom, individualism, privatism of money, of their own private space, and all of these things. And so what he started to learn and realize as they would talk is that none of these people were actually racially motivated to move away from these things. Now, I know we see like illegals and things like that, and we automatically associate that with minority groups, because they are. And so he realized that these people, their desire to move away from those things was not racially motivated. But the fact that they separated themselves created a very clear racial divide. Because as we know, these things on this side affect minority groups much more. So just their desire to be apart created racism. So the main point from his study was that there can be racism without any racists. That's probably a foreign concept to everyone. What? You can have racism without racists? Yes. You know, so it's important for us to not dismiss a whole conversation based on the fact that we aren't racist. I'm sure a lot of us in here aren't racist, but maybe on some level we've participated in racism. On to my next point. This is the last point, and it is that it's important for us to speak up. So the reason why this is important is probably the hardest part of overcoming racism, the fact that you have to actually take action, you have to move. When we choose to speak up, typically I think we're probably speaking to the people who we love and respect the most, you know, our friends, our family, which makes it that much harder. You know, maybe if someone who you don't know is, you know, saying something that you feel is like belittling you, maybe you'll say something. But to someone who you love, you know, you don't really want to cause conflict and strife in your relationship, you know, over something when you can just be quiet, you know. But the problem is, you know, let's say you're at Thanksgiving and grandma is saying something and it's like, I don't believe that and I think that's wrong. You can't say that, grandma. But you don't say anything. And this is for both groups. This is for, you know, I have some family members who say things that I'm like, you can't say that. You know, so I think it's important to realize that grandma isn't the only one at the table, or uncle isn't the only one. Little Jimmy is at the table too, and we wonder why we can't seem to eradicate what is this cancer. It's because you haven't taught them that it's wrong. So not speaking up tends to say it's okay. Or, and not even that it's right, but just that it's okay, which is enough to perpetuate something that shouldn't really exist. So I just want to end with this one quote by Dr. Martin Luther King from his 1968 speech. It says, "In the end, we will remember not the words of our enemies, but the silence of our friends." Thank you.
Good morning. It's good morning because it's the beginning. It's the beginning of this opportunity to share with you as it relates to my point of view when it comes down to race relation in today's society. Public safety started way before my time. Today it takes 18 weeks for an individual to turn out to enforce the laws here in the state of Georgia. Is that 18 weeks long enough to decide whether your life is more important than mine? Is that 18 weeks long enough for me to be in control of you and what you do? But at the age of 19, that's the opportunity that I was given. Whether or not I took advantage of that opportunity or the difference I made when getting that opportunity is solely left up to me. During that 18 weeks, you finish that training academy. You're now charged with enforcing the laws in the state of Georgia. You walk in and you find out that your salary is going to be $10.98 an hour. You think about it. Don't worry about money. I'm in control. Now we have men and women in uniform because they're in control, making decisions on our lives. Is that right or is that wrong? That part we won't understand, but I can tell you that they're not knocking down the doors to attend the police academies anymore. Because they feel like now you have been given 18 weeks worth of power that you don't even know what to do with. And on top of all of that, now you don't even have enough money to raise a family. But now you're going to make a career in my world. Understanding public safety will be one that you would have to walk in those shoes to understand. Unfortunately, in my line of work, if I get a call, 911 call, emergency, I'm being attacked by a human being, and he's on my street. Well, they fail to realize that the street is 3 miles long. Then they fail to realize everybody is on the street. So who do I respond for help? Race is my line of work. I don't want to go and stop or save someone that was merely wrestling because I failed to take knowledge or heed to the important fact of it was a white male, it was a black male, it was a Hispanic male, red shirt, blue pants. That's our line of work. Whether or not it's fair or understood is the part that we still have to understand ourselves. But in order to be able to render that public service, we have to know who we're rendering that service to. On last week, one of my transport deputies responded to pick up a female that was incarcerated in North Georgia. She was arrested on a shoplifting charge. However, she was wanted in South Georgia for homicide, where she killed a 3-year-old child and placed the child in the closet and left home with the other 3 children. Now, when I go to work that day, had a great breakfast that morning, but that's what I have to deal with. Now, when I go pick up that female, do I hold a different approach to her because she's white or black or Hispanic or Asian? Or do I treat her like the human being that she is? Yes, she has been accused of committing a horrendous crime. A crime that one of those instances, you just want to spend maybe 5 minutes with them. But in my line of work, that is still a human being. Today we share and we look at law enforcement all over the nation, just like your fellow classmate, just like your coworker. Everybody got that professor they just love to attend their lectures, and then somebody has that professor, man, they ain't retired yet. In the same line of work in our profession, that decision has to be made. I choose whether I want to patrol on your street or on their street. But at the same time, what you fail to realize and what you may not know, I got a call saying that it was drag racing on his street. So why did you choose to go to that street? Because as public servants, that's the street I was called to attend. No, we won't understand. Because when you're pulled over side the road, the first thing happens is, man, I know you ain't pulling me over. And I know the 2 people in front of me was going way faster than I was. But what they failed to realize, I can't pull over but one car at a time. And in the midst of that, that was the violator that got caught. But already, you're mad at me. Had a young man, outstanding student here at Georgia Southwestern State University, intercepted one of my deputies late one night. He was arrested and charged and brought to the jail. He complied, didn't understand. Monday morning, he was there in my office. Very studious young man. He had a lot of questions. He wanted to understand why me. After 30 minutes of talking with this young man, he still wanted to know why me. So I asked the ultimate question. Had you been drinking while driving that automobile? Yes, sir. Illegal in the state of Georgia. But there's nothing wrong with him questioning that whole process. But at the end of the day, what did you do to constitute you being pulled over? Don't worry about the fact that my music was playing loud. Don't worry about the fact that my taillight fell off because I didn't get it fixed last week. Don't even worry about the fact that I'm weaving down the road. Don't worry about all that. My rights was violated because I was arrested. The sad part is, yes, we do have bad officers in these uniforms. I promise you, if we could mold and shape the ones that we need to have in our forefront, we will have nobody. If we do have somebody, it'll be one way too far apart. So therefore, there are standards. There are standards that must be upheld, and there are standards that can't be ignored. But at the end of the day, there's a responsibility to each and every one of you here at this university that my job is to keep you safe. Now, I got four people working. Maybe one of them's kind of shaking, but I'm watching. And accountability is important because that's what happened. You have to call them to attention when something is wrong. Now, I'd much rather have someone else, but then when I go introduce myself and talk about that $11 an hour, they tend to walk away. Wonder why. And as we understand that those individuals that make it bad for everybody, because we have some bad ones, we have some officers that wake up in the morning saying that somebody gonna get it today. But what they fail to realize is the amazing part about my world of law enforcement, who's to say it won't be you, the one that got today? Because in our line of work, lives do matter. And our lives matter. But everybody's not going to be the ones that go to the forefront. When I leave home every morning, I tell my family I love you because I committed to a job that I may not come home at the end of the day. And that's the job I signed up for. Whether it's good or bad, indifferent, but that's what I enjoy doing because public safety is important because I have a service to each and every one of you. Things that you don't understand, that's when it's time to ask questions. Get to know your public safety community. Why y'all wear y'all uniform like that? Ask that question. Because what you fail to realize, policy 3.7-9 says you better wear it just like that in order to get a check. You have to wear all of that. And a lot of times people fail to understand. People sign up for this job paying this amount because they didn't sign up for the money. Yes, some signed up for the power, some signed up for the adrenaline rush, but we still have some to sign up to help others. Public safety is something different. And one of the things that the nation has realized, we gotta change the climate of our officers. Yes, I have an automatic weapon on my side ready to shoot at any given time, but is it time to use it now? Or when I'm threatened by someone that's approaching me, is it time to use it now? The difference in my world is I have seconds to make that decision. I don't have minutes. I don't have time to go back to my dialogue team. I don't have time to do analysis. I got to make a decision. But in our nation now, they're looking at law enforcement. They have to better look at situations. Okay, if he's up on the top of this conference room, do I have to shoot now? Or can I de-escalate that situation? Yes, it is coming. However, there are still those bad apples that make it bad for everybody else. But does that mean that every officer you come in contact with is that bad guy? We have to give everybody a chance. Because if we operated in the same fashion, does that mean each and every one of us are bad people? I apologize I didn't stand to the podium, but I get excited about my profession. And I want you to be excited about it because knowingly, willingly, liking or not liking, I think we gotta have some public safety. But at the same time, it's time now for all of us to get engaged in our public safety because I don't respond to a call that I'm not called to. I don't write a report if there's not a report to be written. I don't render aid if I don't know someone is in need of aid. That's called public safety. Thank you.
Moment. I just want to thank Georgia Southwestern State University for the invite. I think it's very important at this critical state in our country to talk about race matter. And go ahead, Tim.
Artists' duty, as far as I'm concerned, is to reflect the times. I think that is true of painters, sculptors, poets.
Can you hear it?
Musicians. As far as I'm concerned, it's their choice. But I choose to reflect the times and the situations in which I find myself. That, to me, is my duty. And at this crucial time in our lives, when everything is so desperate, when every day is a matter of survival, I don't think you can help but be involved. Young people, black and white, know this. That's why they're so involved in politics. We will shape and mold this country, or it will not be molded and shaped at all anymore. So I don't think you have a choice. How can you be an artist and not reflect the times? That, to me, is the definition of an artist.
I'm Sheila P. Bright. I'm a fine art photographer, and I use photography as my weapon to talk about a wide range of knowledge of contemporary culture. My body of work is known for plastic bodies, young Americans, and suburbia. And in 2013, I started looking at young people because of the state of our country. That was the year when Trayvon Martin was murdered, shot down, and we're not talking about all bad cops. And young people are sick and tired of being sick and tired, and that's what starts the movement. So I, as an artist, felt that I needed to take action. So I took my camera and I started looking for the young people that were in the movement in the 60s that were unknown. I found Mr. Lonnie King that started the Atlanta Student Movement in Atlanta with the black colleges, and he said they were sick and tired of being sick and tired. We're not going to take this anymore. And they actually got kicked off of campus for doing it because they said, don't do it, but they said, we're going to do it. And I photographed them. And in the meantime, I started seeing what was happening on the news with Ferguson. And I said, I have to do something about this. So I traveled last year to Ferguson, Baltimore, DC, and I actually started in Atlanta. And I grouped up with the young people, you know, because you have social media right now. And I photographed the uprisings. I happened to be not in Ferguson when it started. I came with the aftermath. And I felt the tension. And this is after the uprising. The young people call it the uprising. And when I went to Baltimore, I was actually there when Freddie Gray passed on that Sunday. And I went to West Baltimore. Didn't know anything about West Baltimore. I'm black, right? So I stepped into West Baltimore and got totally cussed out and said, we don't want you here. Get the hell out. We don't want you, white folks, or the media. Because all you do is when you come into our communities, you always want to talk about the negative stuff, not the good stuff. So I had to really think very fast. And guess who I thought about, you guys? Don Lemon. I don't know if you guys saw Don Lemon in the uprising in Ferguson when they had the uprising, and he said, I think I smell marijuana in the air. I said, that was messed up. I ain't gonna tell you what I said to him. And they said, you're damn right. And so that's how I was able to engage. But my whole point is this, is that as an individual and as an artist, I had to take action. I had to be on the ground to find out what was going on for myself, because a lot of times what you see in the media is sound bites and ratings to get everybody's attention. You know, you can't believe everything. We all have smartphones right now. That's the new media. So I started photographing the young people because I wanted to talk about what was going out there. So I wanted to find a new way of generating how we see things. And I'm going to have an artist talk about my work. But my whole point is that black lives do matter. It started in 2013 with a group of three black women, queer women. And they, when after the trial of Trayvon Martin, it was only for them to talk about the love of black people. It's just like with James Brown. He said, I'm black and I'm proud. But when other cultures see that, oh my God, they're getting ready to start some, that's not it. Black folks have been over in this country and came over here as property, and still might be considered as property. We got the mass incarceration. So my whole thing is about giving the young people a voice and to create a dialogue and to hear their voice. I wish we had more young people when we go to dialogue to really speak, because I know everybody is feeling something. And we must talk about this. And through art activism and my work, that's what my whole purpose is. I am the messenger. I've been on the ground. I saw the frustration. I saw the pain. I saw the love. I saw the hurt. African Americans have been lied to throughout the centuries of this country. And with all of that, I think we need to go ahead and speak. And thank you.
So we now move to our question and answers session. Remember, we have two mic stations. So if you have a question, please go to the mic. You're welcome if you wish to direct it to a specific panelist, or I will.
Hi, I'm Kelly McCoy. I'm Dean of Arts and Sciences here at GSW, and I actually just have a very brief comment. And Sam, I know there hasn't been public outrage over things that are outrageous, but some of us are outraged at it. And some of us recognize those code words used by some of the political candidates and will not vote for somebody who says that. So,
thank you.
Hello, I didn't expect the mic to be as small. But my name is Farron Emanuel. I'm here from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm actually a part of Sheila's 1960 Now project. And these are the type of panels that I would put on when I was SGA president over at Clark Atlanta University to bring about a discussion that's gonna include multiple perspectives. So we would always like to have somebody from law enforcement on the panel. And what I noticed today from you talking, you didn't really touch on, I wouldn't say race per se, you more, which isn't a bad thing for how I'm gonna put it, but you pretty much talked about everything from your line of work and what you're gonna see as an individual going into law enforcement. And it really got me to thinking that most people, like we say things like don't take it personal, but we're people, that's the only way we can really take things. But you're really dealing with everything from your own perspective, and you're pretty much submerged in some circumstances that, you know, in general, you really have no control over. You know, like there are, you know, situations like in Baltimore where Sheila did a lot of her work, where you got, you know, one out of every 20 houses, someone lives in it, and the other 19 are boarded up. You know, and this is like a neighborhood. So imagine being a police officer in that area where you have economic deprivation based on race that you really don't control. You're just kind of put in those circumstances. But, you know, as the president here, and you're using you all's resources to create, you know, what I would term like a treatment program, you know, to help people to, you know, find new ways to think about things and to become better human beings by having these courageous conversations. But my question is more general, so I'll just wrap it up. All of you all coming from different, you know, perspectives or different fields, and I think this would be something for us in the audience to think about too. But like, what could you do as an individual, you know, dealing with the circumstances to kind of better, you know, the relationship between people of different races? So like if you're a white person or you're a black person, you know, like how are you gonna go about changing the relationship and changing the circumstances based off the relative power that you have as an individual in your line of work, in your daily life? So.
And I can respond to one of them. One of the things as it relates to building those relationships is having an open atmosphere. Nobody wants to approach that person that's either sheltered off or has that aura of don't come around me and don't ask me any questions. So in our community, we're small enough where we can engage in different civic organizations, different on-campus functions, and that type of thing. And it gives you the reality to know I'm still a human being. You know, hey, you got a question about something. And I think that's important as we build relationships with the community, and not just at the secondary learning institutions, but also at the elementary schools and at the daycares, at the civic meetings, at the Bible study groups. That's what we have to do. And then once that invitation has been extended, you'll find that people will come to you and say, I want to ask you about something. And that's, from my point of view, what we have to do. Have an environment that people are comfortable questioning you about what you do. And of course, not taking it personal when questioned.
I would say, as an artist, I think it's important for whenever I'm making work to not just make these like factual statements. Over time I learned that really what I'm doing is I'm posing questions, you know. So I think the question to your question is, who's in your circle? You know, so who is in your circle? And I know it's easy to be like, well, I have some black friends or I got some white friends, but you know, how deep is your relationship in with the individual? You know, I think for me, if I was to say in one word, what is the solution to all of these problems, my thought is empathy. But you know, the question to that answer is, how do you gain empathy? How do you learn how to empathize with someone who is different than you? And I think the only way is to, you know, like you said, to kind of open yourself up. I mentioned that it's difficult and it's not an easy thing to talk about these things, but I don't think it always has to be a thing where we're talking about race. You know, like, I have some white friends, or I have some Asian friends, or I have some friends who are just different than me, who believe in different religious views or whatever. And as we get to know each other, I get to know about what they believe. Not even because I asked them, but because that's just how relationships work. And then over time, you know, I don't have to, you know, there's this idea of like social parsimony, where we decide that, okay, I don't really like black people, but you're okay. But the rest of them, they're not okay. You know, so it's like, what is that? And I think you can only think that if you don't even really know that black person who you are like, yeah, I'm cool with you. But once you get to know them and you realize that they are me, they are also them, then you can't really make distinctions in that way that's like they're different. And, you know, you just kind of learn to connect and understand some part of your humanity is essentially the same as theirs.
Okay.
Yes, my name is Sherry Small, and I would like to propose an ideal to the Colonel. Well, I know it's a difference between the north and the south parts of town. Would it be a good ideal to maybe get cops on feet in the areas that you think they're most needed, than to just riding is not helping the solution? I mean, you know, bringing a solution. So I would suggest, where I'm from, if you feel it's a bad area, because some people feel offended when they're not involved in being stopped for no reason, or, you know, they allege that the person is doing. So I would say to make a start, you know, I'm just suggesting, in the areas that you don't think that are properly mannered, or just try, you know, get them out on feet. And I think then you can better talk with the people in the area, and they will understand that you mean business, and everybody would feel more united or wouldn't feel offended by being stopped in a certain part of town. Thank you.
And that's okay. One of the things I don't want you to do is be a county commissioner, because if you look at my fuel budget or my vehicle repair budget, they may say that's a good idea. One of the things that, from a retention standpoint, especially in a community our size, you have to look at where your manpower needs are and where they are the strongest. Of course, today, manpower need may be more so out in the field, or filling the slots to answer the calls for service. But we are trying to get back towards a direction of community policing where you would be more comfortable because you know, hey, that's officer friendly. So you would have a better relationship with your public safety. But that goes on into retaining, which retention in law enforcement now, if you notice, most agencies are almost 50% as it relates to turnover rates and retaining officers. But that's a work in progress, and it'll definitely help strengthen that relationship. Thank you.
I would just like to say that in years of doing this work, one of the things that has happened over time is that we talk about code words, is that folk have learned to become incredibly politically correct because talking about race has usually, we've usually come to the place where whenever you talk about race, you're walking in a minefield. And so and nobody wants to get blown up. So what we learn to do is not talk, because if we don't talk about anything, then we don't have to worry about getting blown up. And a lot of times, part of what we're saying is out of ignorance in terms of being unaware, not ignorant, which is something else. But we just really don't know. And so part of my experience as a young person was I was around folk who were willing to take my naive questions, you know, and not blow me up when I asked them. You know, they would laugh at me mostly, but, you know, we were 15. And so I learned a lot of things that I didn't know just because the folk that I was asking the questions of were willing to have me ask those questions and not blow me up. And I think sometimes that's what happens to us now is we're just so afraid to say something offensive or we don't know what's offensive, or we do know what's offensive, but in some cases we don't know, so we just stop because we just want to play it safe. And if we could get to a place where we really talk to each other and don't have to worry, it is a safe space, we don't have to worry about somebody blowing us like, I can't believe you asked that. Well, you don't even, half the people don't even know what I say. You know, because if you're coming from a different perspective, you don't even understand sometimes why that would be offensive. So I think we need to get to a place where we can actually have some honest dialogue and ask those things in a safer space. And when we do that, you know, part of my presentation was common ground. You do find out that we have a lot more common ground. Certainly we have differences. You know, the other thing is this whole thing, the notion of being colorblind. Okay, like when I see you, I don't even see a black person. Really? Why not? You know, like I am. The problem isn't seeing it, it's a problem the meaning that you attach to it, the meaning that's been attached by society to certain things. Seeing it is not the problem. Okay, you know, there are folk who say, I'd like you to see me. I'm proud of my culture. I'm proud of where I come from. I'm proud of my heritage. So when you negate that, then you just took me out of the conversation because you're not seeing me anymore. You know, so looking for that common ground and giving folks, you know, respect, you know, as we try to struggle with it together, because it's nothing we can do by ourselves. But back to the point Sam made about really it is on white folks to try to teach other white folks. And again, if you want to blow everybody else up, that's fine. When I was a young revolutionary, I did that too. All right, but I learned over time that it's better for us to try to find some conversation and hold folk accountable for things they say, you know, but there's a way to hold folk accountable and there's a way to educate people, and it isn't always blowing everybody up, so.
We have a question here.
Hello, my name is Brandon Foster. I'm an English major, and one thing I've been, there's without a doubt, there's a lot of racial protests in this country, and it has been going on for a few years. While voices are being heard, it doesn't seem like much of anything has been doing anything to reach peaceful unity. Like maybe a police officer would be fired or a politician would be thrown in jail and he loses power, but there's still a lot of protests. And my question is, what's the next step and what more can we do to reach out and help those who don't understand or who refuse to understand?
Well, first of all, with me being on the ground, a lot of people think last year was a lot about disruption, and a lot of people from black and white felt that the disruptions, why they continue to do it. I feel that I think you have to have all that noise because it is helping. Some of the people from the Black Lives Matter movement have met with President Obama. If you go on, I'm the one that has this reading list, and because a lot of people are not familiar with Black Lives Matter because of how it is presented and perceived in media, but they have demands, and some of their demands have been met with politicians. I was with the New York Justice League, and they marched from Washington to New York to Washington, D.C., and handed over a package to the Congress in which some laws were passed. So it's not going to take, it's going to take time, you know. And I feel that young people, you're the largest, the millennials are the largest generation in history. They're bigger than the baby boomers. You guys are more diverse. You were 67 million strong by the year of 2006. And you guys are the ones that's going to have to make the change. We can't tell you really how to do it. Mr. King, because I'm in the middle, I deal with the elders. He said, I'm just sick and tired of being sick and tired. If there's something that you have an issue with or a problem with, take action. And it's not going to happen overnight like that. And one thing that Mr. King did tell me, he said, you're never going to get the masses of the people. There's only going to be a few select, like Mr. Mahone. You were part of SNCC, right? Part of SNCC. You're not going to get the masses of the people. But I tell you what, a lot of people benefited off of the civil rights movement, and I think they have forgotten about that, too. So you just have to take action within your own self, and I think this is a... What better time right now? You were talking about, you know, we have to, I don't know if you, tell me if I'm wrong about, is a safe place to talk about race. We need to talk about right now. I would like to hear more from the young people. Is anything going on with your campus? I mean, you need to speak up, because if we could have a healthy conversation about it, it could be a start. You know, with my artwork, I'm going to a lot of universities and everybody is quiet. They won't talk because they are afraid to talk. Because we all have perceptions of one another. But we got to start somewhere, and this is the time to start.
And I think these settings, I'm sorry, but I think these settings give you that stepping stone in order to be more comfortable in relating to your communities, your involvement, because you're important too. But to focus on your question, one of the things that has to happen is that when we began the protests and the marches, you know, in January, somebody needs to follow up in December to see whether or not, hey, what happened in that case? Because we're marching on something else now. And that's what we have to do. We follow that winning professional football team throughout their entire season, and that's what has happened. And you'll find that our judicial system, they're putting them in jail. That's what they deserve. They're prosecuting them. But you won't hear about that. We have to, that same organization has to go back and say, hey, did you know that officer got 30 years? Or, hey, did you know that officer got off? You're going to hear that part, but you're not going to hear about the ones that are prosecuted. I'm sorry.
I would like to apologize why I left, but I couldn't contain myself. It's just like Jeremiah said, just like fire shut up in my bone, and that's the word of God. I mean, I got one thing to say. If we think that racism is just whites are only racist, then that's the problem. I was 4 years old when Martin Luther King got killed, and I looked at my daddy, and I say, what's the problem, Dad? We all got the same God. And he told me, he said, son, you know what's going on. So I'm my heart is heavy. I mean, what more do we want on GSW? I have watched people... They only play our music in activities. I don't hear any white artist music. What more do we want? I mean, you got to love this thing. You got to love. I'm strong in this thing. I've been 4 years old, and I never in my life used the C word to describe a white person. But why is this? Why we can't get away from calling ourselves the N word? We want to take down the flag, but we don't. We want to hold on to the N-word. I had to stop myself from saying that. My whole family, we said we're going to stop. We got leaders that lead us down the wrong path. They're thinking, saying that racism is on one side, And by the, what I heard from the Bible and by if you believe in God, every man has sins. So we got to find out what our sins is. This thing did not start just because the white man. Nobody slaves. Nobody are slave owners anymore. So what's the problem? Laugh at racism. I mean, at slavery. That's what I do. I carry a smile on my face all the time. I have always genuinely loved Caucasian and mixed race. I mean, we got the same God. If a four-year-old can say that, and I'm 51 years old, you can imagine how strong it is now. So that's all I got to say.
Well, give us your name and your major.
I'm sorry, I didn't do the rules. My name is Eddie James Terry. I am a psychology major, and I will be graduating, hopefully, this semester. I'm sorry for that.
Okay.
But my heart is heavy. Sometimes I get in my dorm room, and I'm about to cry. But I want you to know this. In spite of the things that are going on, and I'm not ashamed to say this, God is getting his people together. That is a remnant being formed. And it's going to be a remnant. Whites going to be saved. Everybody going to be saved out of the whole race of people. Now, we can keep on with this mess that we want to, but it's a remnant being saved. And God is moving.
Okay.
I'm not sure how to respond to that, but thank you, sir. This is it Eve?
Right here.
Thank you. Good afternoon. My name is Lakeisha Griffin. I work closely with Sheila Pree Wright. I'm a cultural producer that spent a year at an African American history museum last year, the Reginald F. Lewis Museum, which is a Smithsonian affiliate. And I just want to commend the university and the staff and the people sitting before us, because we are just people with ideas, and ideas are like seeds. So once you plant an idea, it can really take off and become something just, you know, huge, or it can be a bad weed, you know. And I'm glad he mentioned psychology, because when we hear the word racism, it's different from prejudice. You can like me for whatever, you can hate me for whatever. But when you begin to affect the quality of my life, that's a different type of threat to me, okay? So what has happened in our world is that we have a social engineering problem, because we're a room of diverse people right now, but we hear black and white, and that means something. We hear race, and that means something, you see? Thank you for saying we got to deprogram. We have to, because until we understand that we have to have a goal to address these things we fear, we're constantly divided. We can hear something that says, make America great again. It wasn't great for everybody. My great-great-granddaddy was hanging from a tree. It wasn't great for me, guys. Now, that's not personal. You didn't do that. But what it means is a level of psychology about who you are and what you fear, and you're telling on yourself. How many of you in here know Bree Newsom? Have you heard that name? Have you heard of DeRay McKesson? Have you heard of Devin Allen? These are your peers. You're saying it looks like it's nothing happening? Oh, yes, it is. It's some things happening. Devin Allen is the young man who made Time Cover Magazine when Freddie Gray was, when the uprising happened in Baltimore. And you see a one man running from the National Guard in Baltimore. He was an amateur photographer nobody knew about until he started putting his pictures on Instagram and Twitter and went viral to the extent that Rihanna and Beyonce and you name it was reposting. He made Time Cover. He's the only African-American amateur, and he's about 25 years old, 26 now, and you guys should know your peers. You should know these people, because you know why? Information is your seed. I'm not telling you what to know. I'm telling you just to have some information, not affirmation. Affirmation doesn't get us anywhere. It's good to be in this school. I have 2 degrees. I am not a millionaire. I'm not part of the 1%. You know who the 1% is? the wealthy people who are a very small percent that make $9,700,000 an hour. And we're here divided and afraid to talk about our place in life when there's people who don't even, they're on another planet. They don't even have to come here to talk to us. And they're making decisions about your life. I am happy to be here. I'm happy to see your faces. I leave charging you to take accountability because each and every one of you have a seed that you can plant. Activism is just not the streets. It's food activism because the soil is crap and it's killing us. Find your place. It's about teaching how to create new jobs. You got young people selling t-shirts online, creating boutiques because they know how to code. Anyway, I probably took up too much time, but I just wanted to wish everyone well. And you know what? You can do it. You can do it. I believe it. You're going to be all right. Thank you.
Question here.
Hey, guys. Oh, okay. My name is Manga. People call me Manga. I'm an exercise science student, and I'll try to form this into a question. I'm just going to start talking. So what she was talking about was quality of life, and what I really see, I try to calm down, not really use my emotions as much. There's emotions and logic, and there's always time to use both at certain times. So growing up, I've always been like culturally influenced, and with that, I've been able to hang out with white people, black people, Russians. Like, one of my best friends is like Russian. One of my other best friends is like Italian. I've always kind of try to be diverse because you never know what they see, and it's all about life and perspective. And one thing that I saw with the quality of life growing up, my mom's like, I don't want you to go do something like this because you know they'll shoot you down or whatever like that. And I've always kind of been like, well, you don't know the situation, but you know, sometimes it's always that emotion over logic. So with emotion and logic and being diverse and being around other people, you kind of see how other people play into culture. And in terms of like, my white friends, I've always been around white people. I like them, cool people. But what I've learned is that, you know, when they, like, let's say they want to have a party, they're going to use African-American music. And it's like, I know they will say, okay, I'm not racist. And I believe they wouldn't be racist. It's just that, you know, certain things is that, like, in terms of hip-hop, so diverse or so embedded into African American culture, it's just like, hey, you like hip hop, oh, you're also African American. I'm gonna tie that into, you can probably dance. So can you dance for me? So you're seeing the beginning, like, hey, this white person is saying, can you dance? To me, it's like, you can't just stereotype me, like blah, blah, blah. Oh, now I'm gonna claim as you as a racist. Is like, there's really like steps behind the mind of stuff like that. And I feel that certain things, like they were saying, we have to deprogram. And then I don't know who said it before, but it was something about the government not really having an official apology. And I remember I was looking on social media up there trying to figure out where I saw it. But it was something where it's like they had all these important times in the U.S. government, like the Emancipation Proclamation, the Civil Rights Act of 1964. There was something else that happened in 1990, I think. But it's like all men are created equal, but at the time, slaves weren't men. So things just kept going over and over, and people get upset over and over. So all this will happen, settle down, and then another document comes. But it's never like, one, an apology, and two, hey, you are actually a person. I don't think that's like legally written anywhere. So because people just assume all men are created equal, forgetting the times that it's happened, it's like, okay, how can we in legislation figure out, okay, this is what's going on, because there's so much uneasiness and unsettling because we just put a Band-Aid on it instead of actually fixing it, and it's about time for another Band-Aid to come on. So, yeah.
Good evening, you guys. I'm Vaquisha Hall. I'm a little nervous, so excuse my language. You know, I'm mixing words up a little bit. My major is exercise science. I'm a junior. I'm an athlete. I play basketball here. Okay, you said we should, like, kind of speak on campus, like, speak about campus. Okay, I noticed that nobody really say nothing, but I feel like it's a problem for me sometimes. The biology department. Okay, it's been kind of a consistent thing where students are failing. I feel like it's becoming unrecognized. Like, there is a serious issue. And when I sit in the classroom, it's like a handful of, you know, black people, and that's a lot of the class around here, and majority is white. And I feel like both are equally, you know, failing just somewhat, because like 80 or 90% of athletes are failing somewhat in the area of biology or anatomy. It's the science department. I feel like it's very frustrating and intimidating sometimes, because I went to my teacher and I asked him, I said, what can I do to better myself or educate myself better? What can I learn? What should I look up? And the answer he gave me was studying tips, advice. I didn't ask you for that. I'm asking you because I'm very concerned with my grade. I have did study sessions with people to advance my knowledge, and for me to sit here and take quiz and just studying, I'm trying to reach out to you, and I get to the test and I take it, and I'm very uncertain, and I'm just unsure because I'm not that student that is just outstanding. I feel I'm average when it comes to work such as that. So I get my test back, I fail. I get a 45 and I'm confused, and I'm trying to reach out to you and you're not helping me. And this becomes a consistent thing when I ask other people, I'm like, what is your grade? Like, are you passing? How do you feel like with the teacher? The teacher's monotone. I feel like the teacher is talking to me. He's not teaching it to me. He's not breaking it down for me to understand. I feel like we're in a society where if you fail, oh, you fail, or you're not studying hard enough. No, I'm sitting here tired and struggling. A teacher said, if you cannot handle this, then I think you should change your major. I feel that is extremely insulting. And this came from a woman in the science department. And frankly, I really don't know what to do. I don't know if this even gonna make a difference. I don't know what step I need to do. Currently, right now, I'm dropping the class because I feel like no one can help me. Some students are capable of teaching themselves. I am not. I came here for you to teach me about this particular subject, not for me to go teach myself. I'd rather for you to teach me and then go back in the book and read up on the knowledge that, you know, that I do not know. Like, I want to study this and, oh, you taught that to me, so I need to look at this. Instead, you're just reading a lecture to me and I don't know what you're talking about. So half the times, black or white, we tend to zone out. We get on our phones. You know what? Teachers don't care, because at the end, they getting a paycheck. They don't care about us. They I'm not going to say everybody, but a lot of teachers, they're getting a check at the end of the day and it does not matter to them. Like, I'm very average when it comes to schoolwork. That is not my strong side. So when I'm being looked over, I'm very frustrated. And for you to tell me to change my major, I struggle with everything personally. So it's very frustrating for me. I'm trying not to get emotional about it because I'm upset. But I'm done. I feel like I might start crying, so I'm done.
I applaud you. I really applaud you for coming out with that, and that's your first step in hearing your voice, and you have the president here. Talk to him about it, how to deal with it. Yeah.
And one of the things, in response to her, one of the things you also have to do, you know, in life you're going to have challenges. And even though, you know, you're frustrated with that person or that subject, now there has to be some determination. whether you drop it today or next semester, you still should follow through with that. And then, like you said, audience like these, let that be known. Now there may be other students together. We'll go talk with that dean or that president, and maybe we can see, because just like in my line of work, you have people that hold jobs that I don't know they're a bad apple until I hear it, saying that, hey, you know, I heard that professor wasn't doing what they're supposed to be doing. Now we know. And come together and work that out. Thank you.
Over here. You.
Okay. Hi, good afternoon. My name is Yixin Chen. I'm from Taiwan, and you can call me Kathy. Okay, I'm psychology major minus sociology. Okay, I have a question because I've been participating several, like this kind of speech about the civil rights, about the races in different campus, and actually, I don't have any background of the racism because I never experienced in my country. And so after I came to America, I just figured out, like, in our cafeteria, like, just black people would sit together, white people would sit together, Asian people would sit together. Well, that was not a very big problem because I understand that when you, like me, I'm comfortable with sitting with them because I have a language problem. I cannot speak English very fluently, and most of the time when you talk to me, I just laugh because I don't understand what you're talking about. Well, so, okay, but I understand that, but my personal experience, I don't feel any racist problem on me because I have a black friends, white friends, and actually, probably because I'm Asian, so there's nothing matter. I'm kind of out of the two circle. But yeah, so I kind of fit in very well for both group. But after I kind of touch on this topic more, for example, last semester I went to the Kansas State University to talk about a field trip for 3 days. Well, at that moment, I learned a lot, but at the same time, I feel a little bit uncomfortable than here, like today. Because when they teach about the race, they teach about the civil right, they used a lot of truth, a lot of media to tell people what's going on in the past. I do understand that when you learn the history background, something going on is matter. But at the same time, I feel like they are passing the message about hate. It's not just only about the fact. So, and also that was kind of struggling with when you want to make attention by people, so you have to peel in with their emotion. So I understand that, but I just feel like I'm educated by hate, like, oh, white people is really bad for some reason, for their what they act before. But which is, I feel that was not a very good way to educate the new people. Like me, I have nothing background, so you don't. I just feel like maybe for educate the new generation, it would be you can demonstrate how white people and black people work together instead of how they act something bad to them. So I just say maybe it was I would just bring it up because I think if you have making something else that maybe can consider a little bit about it. So I just feel like this is maybe another way to think about when you learn something new. And also, I almost still encourage that maybe just next time try to sit beside somebody who is not your race. And it would be a very, very good experience to learn from because there are very different background, which is I learned a lot from students here. Okay, thank you.
Good afternoon. My name is Miles Robinson. I'm a computer science major, and I'm a freshman here. And I just had a quick question for Ms. Bright. I was just wondering, or for me and anybody else that's interested, like, what can we do, or how can we find out more information about the 1960 now?
You can go to project1960.com. And also, since everything is on the internet, if you want to find out information, there's a lot of different types of movement, because a lot of people are not really affiliated with Black Lives Matter. That's more of a branding thing. But there are a lot of young youth that are out. I can give you more information when I see you, but there is a reading list that I have on there that has blacklivesmatter.com, and it'll lead you to different areas with that. You know, did I help you? Yeah, and project1960now.com, you can go on there. Yeah.
You can also, SNCC, Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, still exists in DC. It has a project called the SNCC Legacy Project. In fact, a number of Black Lives Matter leaders have been collaborating with SNCC in terms of some of the strategies that were used in the 60s that can be employed today. There's a recognition that it isn't enough to be responded and be reactive to every incident that happens in these cities and just get out into the streets and express your anger. There has to be a strategy developed for that. And so they've been coordinating. And if you could go online to SNCC Legacy Project, and you'll find some information about how that collaboration is taking place. And there's a lot of information about how you can
And there's another organization called Black Youth 100. They're based out of Chicago, but they have chapters all around. You can actually start your own chapter here in Americus. You have your chapter here at SNCC, right?
Also, the hashtag, because it will lead you to where people are. There's the hashtag Justice, there's the hashtag 1960 Now. I'll show you all of the people that she'll have in the 1960 show that in their tag, so you can follow them on Twitter.
Yeah, and I've been to their meetings. They actually do have strategies, but what you see in the media is all about disruption. And that's how, you know, we actually, the media is the lens which we view ourselves and other people, and that's why we have these racial divides. It stays in the media. It's very divisive. Yeah, very, very divisive.
I just want to add to that, because I think that although it's good that you want to be a part of something and that you want to figure out how to be a part, I think that is important. And I don't want to say anything against what you guys are saying, because I'm sure that what you guys are involved in or a part of is important and is doing good work. But you do kind of have to think about the fact that, you know, Black Lives Matters, they have a movement, but also, like, it's also the media. I mean, it's, you know, in a way, in a sense, you know, I think we should take everything with a grain of salt, not dismissing anything that their organizations are doing. But you need to find out for yourself, because they're going to tell you what they believe. And that might not be what you believe. And if you haven't really figured that out, then you're virtually doing the same thing as listening to someone else. And you're just listening to someone else. So I think, on top of those things, it's important that you kind of educate yourself. She gave you a reading list. I think that's a great place to start. I mean, you don't have to, it's probably a good idea to read the whole book, but you know, like getting something out of, you know, the places that, you know, I think you can go to Google and you can get like, maybe at the most, like a 2-page article, you know, like 2 pages. But if you read a book, like 200 pages on a subject that talks about a variety of different ways to think about it. You know, so I know not everybody here maybe reads or anything, but I mean, we should. But, you know, I understand. So, but I the main thing is I just think it's important to not always just take what someone said. I mean, even when you're reading a book, read one book, and then read the complete opposite book. You know, like, so just, I think it's important to know, you know, she was talking about knowledge and knowing. I think that's really, really important. I mean, I think when you think about, you know, the civil rights movement, when you think about these people who were very impassioned and they moved and they did what they, but you know, in my, the perception that I have of them is that they were very well educated. They were there, so they were very present and physically present, but that they were also, you know, like consuming information that allowed them to move. You know, so it wasn't just, I feel this way, I'm gonna do this, you know, like, I have these feelings, and even if everything that you feel is right and everything that you wanna say is right, you know, not everybody's gonna listen to your feelings. You know, some people you do need to, like, give them some facts and stuff, you know, so I think it's important to just make sure that you're balanced, even if you're going towards something that is right and good.
One thing that I can add on to it, I didn't mean to cut you off, I agree with you, however, you need to, like you said, don't take this for granted with me, but what I'm trying to say is you have to know for yourself. And if you want to go to some of the organizations, whatever, go to and see what it is. You know whether you're going to deal with it or not, you know, that kind of thing. And the young people that I've met that were the elders that were in the movement, they was learning as they were going. They did not know, okay? And they're doing it now. So it's not really about a book, but it's about getting the knowledge. And you got to know for yourself. You really got to know for yourself. But I encourage every young person, if you want to know about anything, it's not the TV. Get on the ground. I mean, it blew me away. I mean, when I was in Baltimore, it was like a circus. CNN, all the media was in Baltimore. They had their little tents and everybody's reporting, and they were telling them to get the hell out. We don't want you here. By the time they had the camera in the face like this, they were going off on them, and that's what you see in the media. So you've got to know for yourself. Don't take my word. That's what I was saying. Don't take my word. Yeah.
Okay, question.
Well, I got a comment. My name is Sean Thomas. I'm a graduate in the Business Administration Department. And I've been at four different universities around the country. I've been in Maryland, UMBC. I went to Louisiana. I went to Grambling State University, HBCU. I went to Ohio University last year, and now I'm here. By far, this has been the most tension racially I've been at. I lived in every single part of the country, being down south. I ain't gonna lie, when I came down here, I was kind of scared to get off campus in these backwoods. I'd never seen such a big cotton field before in my life. So when I just like coming down in this culture, I'm originally from Indianapolis, Indiana. So coming down into the Southern culture, I just feel like the first thing I think about when I see cotton fields, I think of slaves. So, and I feel like a lot of people in this region still had that mentality that's way back in the day that has not been progressive. And coming from and living on different parts of the country, I lived in Los Angeles for a few months, and just being around the country, I've seen different mindsets of people. And here it's probably been like the most, the opposite of progressive, whatever that word is. And I say that because not because it's, not because I'm just trying to put it down, but it's something that we need to, like you said, is we gotta get out of denial and own it, because when we're not, when going, like the girl said, when she goes to the lunch cafeteria, you see the white people over here, black people, Asians. You see that everywhere. Like I go to the clubs at night, you see it. You go to the library, you walk around campus, you see it. Like it's there, but it's almost like it's accepted down here. Like where I'm from, we don't see that. You know what I mean? Like that's not common. But here it's just like, it's kind of like the norm. It's part of like the culture, I guess. And like one thing I've seen a lot too, I see a lot of Confederate flags. Like, I mean, I'm like, and we got past that, but down here people just still holding on to it. So. It's just a part of the culture that I'm not really used to yet, and it's kind of interesting, and I'm glad we had this, because a lot of people are still stuck in that mindset of, like, it's still the 50s, still the 60s, and some people still in slavery. Like, yo, we got to get past that. Like, you know what I mean? So that's one thing I'll ask for, not just like, because you know it's a lot of black, white, everybody here. Like, it takes everybody to make a change. You know what I mean? Like, we have a problem, and everybody needs to be a part of that, the solution. So. That's about it.
That's a great point.
Thank you.
That's a great point. I thank you for that. And for students in particular, it's very important that you not be isolated solely on the campus here. If you walk outside this campus, you can clearly see the line of demarcation in the city. Someone talked about how there's clearly a black community, there's clearly a white community. There's very little interaction between the two. When you look at the economics of the city, you see the wide disparity in income, in housing, even the way the streets look. America has had a lot of landmarks, historical landmarks, that have been completely wiped away, destroyed. as if no history really existed here, and as far as African Americans were concerned. In the 1940s, there's a building that still stands called the America's Colored. It was called the Colored Hospital. In the 1940s, they graduated more black doctors, African American doctors, in New York, Chicago, D.C. combined. In the 1940s, that building still lies over there. Cotton Avenue was the epicenter of black commerce in this town. If you walk down Cotton Avenue now, you'll see virtually no buildings at all that exist there. But it was a line, it was like America's Harlem, if you will. That has been wiped away. When you look at the development in the city of America's now, you see all the development going south to the white community, but none going north. It's virtually a wasteland. So you have to look at the economics of how resources are being put out there. And that's when you see, that's what I talk about. When we talk about racism is power, that's what the power is. You have control over where the money goes, who gets to benefit from it, who prospers, who doesn't prosper. That's the crux of this whole discussion. We're not here to indict anybody. We're not here to talk against white people. There are some white people who are the blackest people that I know. You know what I mean? In thought. They get it. You know what I mean? So it's not about that at all. But we have to start confronting people and letting people know that this problem exists. And we need soldiers. We need you to become soldiers, especially young people. You're the ones, you're the guys who got to do this. You're the ones who have to do this. I just turned 70 years old in September of this year. I'm almost out of here, you know? So you're the ones who have to hold up that banner. You're the ones who have to take up the fight. And so I challenge you, when you leave here today, make a difference. Learn more about this diversity program and see how you can make a difference and have an impact. Thank you.
Okay. These will be our last three questions or comments. Four, and that's it. Okay.
How y'all doing? My name is Cameron Barrett. I'm a freshman here at GSW, and my major is biology. Really, this is geared towards the artist in the panel. Throughout the years, there has been many people who have tried to use art to advocate for Black Lives Matter or peace. And I was wondering, has your art made a change? I don't want to say made a change, because evidently a change hasn't happened yet, but has your art influenced people across the cities of, what you say, Baltimore, Ferguson, really the whole nation, to want to make a change, to progress above what we've been seeing in the news, like murder of black youth and, well, it's beyond black youth now, black people in general? Has your art really influenced people to try to do better in terms of that? Or is it more geared towards self-gratification, like I'm trying, but you don't really want to see a change? It's more geared towards yourself, if you get what I'm saying.
Well, no, it has become bigger than me, actually. I started this in, like, last year. The work actually premiered at the Museum of Contemporary Art in Atlanta. I am traveling because of this body of work. Now, when it comes, a lot of the universities are calling me because they feel that they have a problem on campus and we have to talk about this issue because, like I said, you are the youth. You guys are the one that's going to make the change. So through my art, I believe that I am making a difference. I was at University of Tennessee and everybody would not talk from the whites to the blacks. And I actually got them to talk, and they came up and hugged me. Because what I'm trying to do is, I'm an Army brat. I grew up around diversity, okay? It wasn't until I came to the South as an adult, I asked my mother what in the hell was going on down here, okay? And so, yes, you can use it. I didn't explain all of this, but the video that you saw was Nina Simone. I don't know if see her, what happened to Nina Simone. She was actually an artist. It's the season for the artist right now. Look at Beyonce and what she has influenced. It created a dialogue, didn't it? Right. So art has a way of creating a dialogue. Now, I don't know personally if it helped. People have come up to me that said that you have made us see things a little bit different. So it's a start. It's nothing that's going to happen overnight. Yeah. At least it's a start to talk about it.
And also, can we go on that website that you said to see your art pieces? Because I really
project1960.com. And I should have put that on there, SheilaPBright.com. I give it, and you could go to my IG at SheilaPBright. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. And I'm doing a talk, so you'll see what's going on with that.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Yes.
I'm actually going to Florence, Italy to talk about this, okay? The students in Florence, Italy is looking at the state and the condition of America and racism, and I will be leaving next week to talk about this body of work.
Hey, y'all. My name is Lexis, and I am an exercise science major. If I sound shaky, it's because I'm cold. But I just want to touch on what Chandler said about the separation and the young lady here about the separation on campus and that it's accepted. Yeah, it kind of is. And to be honest, it's sad and it's stupid. Me, I may not look like it, and I apologize if I don't, but I'm a very open-minded, open-spirited type of person. Get along with anybody. You come to me, I'll come to you. Just like my friend Mindy here, we met talking about tea and coffee one day last week. You know, we just made friends. But with me, I'll walk around anywhere I go, I always speak, or I'd say hey, or I smile to anybody. And some people, and I'm not gonna lie, it's a handful of people in here, some people just look at me like I'm crazy and they keep walking, or they look straight past me as if I'm not there. Now I always acknowledge people that I see and smile. Now sometimes I'd be like, well, they're not gonna speak, then I'm not gonna speak to them either. But then I have to overlook that and be like, you know, it is what it is. People are who they are. I'm gonna keep speaking. If you don't, then that's your problem, and keep it moving. But yeah, it is alive and well, especially down here in the South. Sorry that you had to see it. Thank you.
You guys maybe could start something. Like you said, you talk to everybody. Maybe you guys need to go to the lunchroom and start sitting with different people, like the Asian. I didn't want to say, y'all do that. Y'all initiate that, okay?
Okay. Right here.
My name is Willie Lewis, and I'm an accounting major. And I would like to know, how do you guys feel about the, presidential debate that's going on right now? You know, like, there's a lot of protesters that's, you know, going against, Trump, and they're getting closed down and stuff, you know what I mean? So, how you feel about that?
I couldn't hear the question. Sorry.
How do you feel about the
presidential debate
on Trump?
Oh. I don't know.
You got a minute?
For that, yeah.
Okay, so there are so many things that could be said, but one of the things we talked about earlier was code words. And so when we talk about make America great again, for some folks, that's what we call a dog whistle, which is really make America white again. And that's not everybody feels that way about Donald Trump, but there are many people who do. And so when we send out those kind of messages and we look at what's happened over the last week, at everything, you know, we're at a point, we're at a critical point, because that divisiveness, the divisiveness, depending on how you like to say the word, that is key, all right, to keeping, as long as we stay divided, there will be no challenge to power ever. And so every time something like this comes up, it's always, there's always an effort, you know, to scapegoat someone. And, you know, it's either Muslims or immigrants. It's a toss-up right now, you know. So you have to really look at things critically for yourself and decide what does each of the candidates stand for, what do they believe in, what are they putting out there, and what are they doing for all the people, you know, and where are we going to end up depending on who you vote for. So it's not my job to tell you who to vote for, but it is my job to ask you to critique and really look at what folk represent and what they, you know, what they are looking for, and what they are putting out there.
You got to understand also that Trump is echoing the sentiments of a number of not just presidential candidates, but this has been going on since the ascension of Barack Obama as president of this country. Well, long before that, actually. But when I mentioned earlier about whenever there was an advancement of African Americans in this country, there's always that backlash from the far right, mostly, who want to keep you in your place. This is what's happening. But what is happening now is that you're seeing a circle of firing squad, so to speak. The chickens have come home to roost. They put this fire and venom out there for the last 8-9 years. And this has produced someone like Trump to have these dog whistles and to have these, to keep repeating these code words that it incites pretty much the races in this country. It's a very dangerous time because it's provoking people to do things they might not ordinarily do. People are being attacked at his rallies. People are walking into churches with guns, killing people, black churches. There's been an outpouring of that kind of violence around the country. And this is because this has been happening over the last 9-10 years. The chickens have come home to roost, and that's what's happening now. So we have to, with all deliberate speed, fight against that. You can do that by going to the ballot box and voting against anybody who endorses that kind of rhetoric. But more importantly, we have to be aware that this is going to happen over and over and over again. As I mentioned earlier, after Reconstruction, we had the fear tactics of the Klan, we had Jim Crow, everything to keep people in place to control people. That's carried over into today. And that's why it's so important to have discussions like this. We have to know what it is, call it what it is, recognize it, and call it out.
I'm just going to go all the way on this one because I already put myself out there, but we have to understand economics. We have to understand what's going on with folks. Okay, as we look at declining economics and we look at people being pitted against each other and people competing for what appears to be scarce resources, for some folks, as we go through the Browning of America, okay, some folks are getting real scared, okay? And for some, all they have left is their whiteness, because they don't have a job and they don't have a future and they don't have a lot of things, so they're holding on to that whiteness because at one point in time that meant something to them and it means something. So when we worry, when we talk about this Make America White Again, it means put you back in your rightful place, put you where you should be and put everybody else where they should be. And I wonder, the sister that was sitting here, the good old days were only good old days for some folk. If you were a woman, you couldn't get credit. There were a lot of things, you couldn't control your body, you couldn't do a lot of things. Okay, if you're a person of color, that you know, their rights stripped left and right, or never granted. So when we look at these kinds of things, that's what we need to look at, is what is being said, and where are we, and then where are we? Because you have the privilege of being in college. All right, you have the privilege of being here, and we're challenging you, and you're challenging yourselves. When somebody tells you that they don't know who David Duke is, okay, if you don't know who he is, please Google him quickly, okay? But when somebody was running from the president of this United States, who once knew who he was but seemed to have gotten amnesia, I think he needs a checkup, okay? All right, that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. And I just want to say one thing. When I did a little experiment with my class earlier. When some folk hear Black Lives Matter, what they're hearing is that people are saying no other lives matter. That was never what it was about, okay? It's Black Lives Matter too, or period, okay? Black Lives Matter, okay? It's not that all lives matter. Of course all lives matter, but that's not the evidence that we're seeing in our society. And so the movement came out of the fact that our lives matter and folk can't be treated any kind of way. And so it isn't so much that your life doesn't matter, it's that I want you to notice that my life matters because it doesn't appear that it's mattering for one evidence that I see out and about and in my society. Thanks.
Our last question or comment.
Very brief. I didn't actually intend to be the last comment, but hopefully this will be useful. I'm Susan Bragg. I teach history on this campus, and I don't teach history because I like to memorize stuff. I teach history because I think it matters, and people in this classroom or in this auditorium obviously are part of this history, and I've learned a lot. But one thing that's really sort of standing out to me right now, when I first got here, in one of my earlier classes, students actually came to me and said, we need an organization to talk about these uncomfortable issues. I had three young African-American women, and very soon we had a club that is now formal. We have a constitution. It's the Queens and Kings of Equality, Quake. It was amazing, right? I was excited. It was wonderful. And they were independent. And there are actually some people here who remember that. But they graduated. And guess what? We have no Quake right now. And you know, Mr. Lonan had mentioned the ability to actually handle conflict, to actually talk through conflict. Quake was a place where people came together and did that. We had queer, we had straight, we had men, we had women, we had African Americans, we had whites. We had this really interesting, diverse group. So when we think about sort of where we go next, we have to look outward, and we have to sort of also sort of think about what we can do, and all of you guys. I mean, again, those students, they didn't come to me saying, will you make us a club? They came and said, will you be our advisor so we can make a club, right? So I would actually really encourage all of you guys, yeah, I'm happy to actually be an advisor, but, you know, it really is the kind of student energy that creates that long-term vision for change. So go students, yeah. Right?
I definitely want to add to that. I know before, you know, I was talking about, you know, educate yourself, make sure you know what's going on. And I do agree with Sheila's point, though, that it is, like, there is so much power in if you go do it. You know, I have certain things that I feel very convicted and strong about. And, you know, there were moments when I realized, like, if I try and, you know, wait for this to happen so I can do it, then, you know, sometimes it just doesn't really work out that way. And, you know, then when you go out and you do it, it galvanizes you. You know, you already had the energy to do it. But then you go take action on the things that you feel very strongly about. It galvanizes you that much more. I'm sure those people who started Quake, you know, they had already in their mind, you know, man, we really feel strong about this. I'm sure the moment that their organization was like, this is actually happening, you know, they were probably doing it even more and, you know, more boldly or, you know, however. So I do definitely agree, you know, like feet on the ground, hands in whatever saying for hands, like, do that. I think it's important, and that is what makes change. So, yeah.
Sam, stay close. I don't want to take over the moderator's duties here, but I want to thank our students, and I want to echo what Chandler said. The Council on Diversity approached me and said, there's a climate on campus that we need to be aware of, and I agree. I've been here all of a year at Georgia Southwestern, and I've talked to many of our student leaders, Student Government Association, the leaders of the Student African American Brotherhood. I've talked with some of our individuals in the cafeteria as we dine together, and I've asked them about the campus climate. And I've got differing opinions. Some say it's not a problem. I integrate well with all the races. Some say, yeah, you know, we're kind of siloed in our sororities and our fraternities. I don't disagree with that. There's a culture of that. But I look to our students to be the change. I am the president of the university. I'm going to affect change at this university in certain ways. But we're talking about a student body of almost 2,800 students. You are the change. You have to decide to act differently, behave differently, have open discussions, work with me as the president to affect that change. And I can only affect that change in working with you as the students. So I look to have some of those conversations again on April 29th at 4:30 in this building so that I can hear from our student body as we look to set the course of this university. What you share with me will be part of our strategic plan that we're developing. And for you students, you'll hear more about the strategic planning process in the near future. And while the past is certainly important and we should all absolutely learn from it, it's you that set the future. It's you that set the future. So I want to thank you for your time. And Sam, I'll turn the duties back over to you. Thank you.
Now, for those that were taking notes, the president meant March 29th instead of April. We would like to thank the members of our panel for volunteering their time, their expertise. We would also like to thank those who put the panorama together, including the Panorama Planning Committee. And if those are present, please stand so people know who they are. We'd like to thank Technology Services as well as our campus community, but most importantly, we thank you, the audience, for your willingness to participate in this event. Just as a reminder, there will be an artist talk featuring Sheila Pree Bright upstairs in the library, followed by a reception in the lobby of the Fine Arts Building immediately following our adjournment, which is now. Again, thanks for attending.